rise of salsa, a musical explosion ignites at Yankee Stadium. The new genre of salsa music had been largely unknown to the world and music industry. But a breakthrough 1973 concert held in iconic Yankee Stadium was the specific event that allowed salsa to develop into a triumph for a community and its music, which would eventually be heard around the world. It is, however, tragic that the mainstream United States paid little to no attention, considering it had been created in the depths of Bronx, New York. The state of Indiana's tragedy regarding salsa would be the fact that most Hoosiers would have and still might only associate Latin music with the Mexican music such as Tejano and Mariachi, when in fact it is so much more. Triumphantly for Indiana, 21 years after the concert, salsa would find itself to become popular in the mid-90s. This would lead to the founding of the Jazz Kitchen, famous for their Latin nights every Thursday, and this year celebrated their 25th anniversary, April 1st of 2019, hosted by the founder slash owner, David Ali. The reason why the concert was such a breakthrough is due to the significant audience, the new music industry genre that was established across the globe due to the new recognition and exposure, and the considerable investment by the promoters, along with the community.
The idea came because we had Puerto Ricans, Cubans, Dominicans, and the Fania All-Stars, two Jews and an Englishman. And when you make a salsa, you have different condiments. I said, this is perfect for the Cuba salsa.
Most believe the official birth of salsa is August 26, 1971, when the Fania All-Stars performed live at the Cheetah Club. While that may be the case, it wasn't until 1973 when Fania and other Latin bands played in Yankee Stadium where salsa finally became exposed to the world. Other bands included El Gran Combo, and the drummer, Mongo Santa Maria. Johnny Pacheco and Jerry Masucci were the co-founders of Fania Records. Pacheco was the band leader, while Masucci handled the business side of things. Before Fania, Pacheco was tired of other record companies taking profit from his record sales. He then co-created Fania with the help of Jerry Masucci, and for the most part, focused on paying their musicians fairly. Masucci was responsible for organizing the Yankee Stadium concert, giving Fania credit for the global boom of salsa. While Fania is credited for giving birth to salsa, they did not create the individual sounds that make it up. These beats and rhythms unique to salsa were originally unique to other music genres that originated from various sections of the Caribbean. For instance, Cuba and Puerto Rico. Mambo, for example, a Cuban style of music with its Afro-Cuban rhythms, heavily influenced several genres of Latino music. The clave instrument and rhythm is a key part of many other rhythms in Caribbean music. The instrument is very simple, only consisting of two solid wooden sticks that are no longer than the average hand. While it was Cuba's African-inspired rhythms, it was Puerto Ricans living in New York who would be most known for blending the sounds that would define salsa. Puerto Ricans would also be the majority in the audience of the 1973 concert because of the significant Puerto Rican population in New York City during the decades leading up to the concert. When organizing the event, Fania was told to put in a couple Motown or rock and roll bands just to get people to come and fill seats. Fania, however, ignored their advice and stuck to exclusively Latin bands.
I never forget, I went there sitting on the pitcher's mound at Yankee Stadium. I'm looking up and there's nobody in the stadium. And all of a sudden, they started to come. And then we had, about 45,000 people there tonight.
Their gut was right. Their audience completely backed them up by completely filling the stadium. Comparing this event to the Beatles' 1965 concert at Shea Stadium, the Beatles filled Shea with 55,000 people, only 10,000 more than Fania's 45,000 at Yankee Stadium. While this is a notable difference, Fania's audience was most, if not all, Latino or Afro-Latino. While the Fania All-Stars expected there to be a sizable audience, while law enforcement did not, they provided Fania with little to no protection due to the fact that they did not expect the massive turnout. The audience was so out of hand that before the Fania All-Stars could even finish their first set, they were bombarded by fans who had rushed the stage located near second base. Tragically, they ended up stealing tons of instruments and equipment that hurt the performers where they hurt most, their pockets. In other words, they hurt them financially. Their overwhelming pride shined so bright that afterwards, things really started to kick off for Salsa. According to Mr. Pacheco, the show was a turning point because music business mavens were suddenly alerted to the profit potential of the Latin market.
I love you for coming tonight, because it proves there's nothing like Latin music.
In later years, more and more musicians, such as Celia Cruz and Ruben Blades, would join the Fania All-Star. And throughout the decade, salsa would become more and more popular across the globe, along with some parts of New York, leaving the rest of the U.S. blind to it all. However, today, the Live at Yankee Stadium album is now on the Library of Congress's National Recording Registry of Culturally, Historically, and Aesthetically Significant Recordings. Thank you.